Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our celebration of the 33rd Sunday in Ordinary Time. A special remembrance of this Mass has been requested for Brenda and Sal.
In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God
and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and my words, and what I have done, and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
reading from the book of Proverbs. When one finds a worthy wife, her value is far beyond pearls. Her husband, entrusting his heart to her, has an unfailing prize. She brings him good and not evil all the days of her life. She obtains wool and flax and works with loving hands. She puts her hands to the distaff and her fingers ply the spindle. She reaches out her hands to the poor and extends her arms to the needy. Charm is deceptive and beauty fleeting. The woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her a reward for her labors. Let her works praise her, the city gates. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response is, blessed are those who fear the Lord.
Blessed are you
who fear the Lord, who walk in his ways. For you shall eat the fruit of your handiwork. Blessed shall you be and favored.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord.
Your wife shall be like a fruitful vine in the recesses of your home. Your children like olive plants around your table.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord.
Behold, thus is the man blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Concerning times and seasons, brothers and sisters, you have no need for anything to be written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief at night. When people are saying peace and security, then a sudden disaster comes upon them, like labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, for that day will take you like a thief. For all of you are children of the light and children of the day. You are not of the night or of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as the rest do, but let us stay alert and sober. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
His master said to him, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Since you are faithful in small matters, I will give you great responsibilities. Come, share your master's joy. Then the one who had received 2 talents also came forward and said, Master, you gave me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more. His master said to him, Well done, my good and faithful servant. Since you are faithful in small matters, I will give you great responsibilities. Come, share your master's joy. Then the one who had received the 1 talent came forward and said, Master, I knew you were a demanding person, harvesting where you did not plant and gathering where you did not scatter. So out of fear, I went off and buried your talent in the ground. Here it is back. His master said to him in reply, You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I did not plant and gather where I did not scatter. Should you not have then put my money in the bank so that I could have got it back with interest on my return? Now then, take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10. For to whoever has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. But the one who has not, even what he has, will be taken away. And throw this useless servant into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
No, our Lord was not in a bad mood when he proclaimed this powerful message to those who hear. But rather, he's trying to shake them up, wake them, so that they pay attention to what they had been given. And so these words can come to us today in a similar way, to stir us into action, to contemplate what we already have, and to realize through this, that in this month, through this time of the year, most of the gospel messages will be reminding us of the final account that we will give to our God. Not just from a perspective that's, yes, looking at the sins we may have committed, the wrong that we have done, but how we have taken possession of the good things that God wants to offer, and how we have used them for the good, our own good, for the praise of God, for our brothers and sisters. There's so much that one could unpack in a gospel like this with the amount of details it has. So, to be kind, I decided to choose but one aspect of it. To think of the talent that we each have. Yes, of course, all of us have individual gifts. There'll be opportunities that one will have and another will not. In a sense, to live out the gospel, to do good for their brothers, to be successful in preparing or providing for themselves and their families, then of course, we're all diverse and different people. But I want to focus on something that we share in common, perhaps our greatest talent, the core gift, and this is our very identity as human people. For each of us has been created in the image of our powerful God, and he's breathed an everlasting soul into us, with an unlimited capacity to receive grace from that God, our Creator. This is no small gift. This is why he entrusts us with so much as a light to go out into the darkness of the world, to spread this light, this joy that comes from hearing the good news and being open to receiving, yes, even more from the Master who wants to share with us so much. There could be a challenge to carry this light. It could be sort of like being outside in the dark with the wind blowing and holding a small candle. There is not always this spiritual perspective. We don't live in a spiritual age. It's very secular. It could be challenging to be a follower of Christ in an outright way today. We can recall the lesson from the Gospel last week, the command comparison between the wise and foolish. For the foolish look at things merely on the surface, but for the wise to go deeper, to think and contemplate in a manner that is consistent with the gift that God has given each of us. Breathing into this immortal soul that God has given is the ability to not just be a biological thing walking around, but we have been given an ability to think, to contemplate what it means to be a human being, to think of our Creator, to seek out the source from which we come, and to seek to know Him as He reveals Himself to His people. This is what separates us from other animals and other creatures we encounter in the world. It stands as a parable if how then to live and use this talent in the age we are in. That can be a challenge if you're like me. You can get worried about a lot of pressure that comes to ignore the distractions that come to us day to day, our individual family and life challenges. We all have different ones. How to carry forth this gift in the world today. And I have an image that I'd like to share with you. It's a little moment from my life, and I bet all of us who have ever driven a car in bad weather have had a similar circumstance. After I was ordained, I was very excited as I could at last, with the money that had been gifted to me and that I had a real salary, I could buy a car. I always driven pieces of junk up until that point. And so I excitedly went and found a car that I liked. It was this little SUV thing, and it had four-wheel drive. And I was sort of proud of it. I thought I could surmount most terrains and get through bad winters, etc. So sometime after I got the car, I ventured into a place where I probably had no business going. I was going actually target practice shooting, and being from upstate, there's no lack of places to do this. There are designated areas of old run-down coal holes, as we would call them. And I drove on to what I thought was solid ground. Well, it wasn't solid. I started to sink, and I felt the car going down. I thought, well, my little Hyundai Tucson won't be daunted by that. I put it in the four-wheel drive, and I put more pressure on the gas, and then I saw the whole thing was sinking deeper. And I saw that tire. As I got out, I looked at this mud, and it's a byproduct made of coal processing, and it's almost like sand and water made out of coal. It's not a fun substance. I was glad I had a black car to begin with, because I was turned coal black and everything that I came in contact with. The reason why I shared this is because it's that image of the tire. So much energy is going in. It's spinning faster and faster and harder, but the vehicle isn't going anywhere. It's just digging itself in deeper and deeper. And I use that analogy often in my mind because we can get stuck similarly, trying to place so much energy on things we have no control over and neglecting to use the gifts that we have right now. That's how the worries of the world can go. By the way, my divine intervention, I eventually shoved enough rocks and even my nice new floor mats underneath the tires and got traction at long last and came up out of this giant hole. Believe me, I never drove back there again, unless if I had a tank, I'm not going back onto that pile. That is a spiritual type of analogy for our spiritual and progress, to recognize what we have right now and putting our effort into where we get spiritual traction. Because each of us, the gift that we have been given, can learn more about Jesus Christ, can have Him be more real in our life day to day, whether it is opening up the Bible more often or for the first time, whether it's learning a little bit more about the church's teachings, praying something in a manner, just giving more time in a way that we didn't before. These are those small ways, but it sets an achievable, realistic goal where we can move ourselves forward, having gotten real traction. This is how this renewal goes forth. We think of the prayer to the Holy Spirit, to send forth to Him into our hearts, to recreate us, but through that renew the face of the earth. God has made us into a church, not just individuals floating around with different pots of grace to receive from, but rather He's given us the ability to make a change this year. Well, before we know it, be in a new church year, it'll be Advent, and we'll ask that question we can every year before Christmas: what does it mean for me that this Jesus Christ became flesh, became a human being to redeem us? How can we make that reality more real? Not just a historical artifact, not looking at Christ as a nice dad or a spiritual ruler or someone from the past, but someone who is real and present to us now. That is our Savior, the one who has conquered even death itself by His and His resurrection power handed on to His people who proclaim the Savior news today. If we make that change, that small thing that we will do to become closer to Christ this year, it starts to transform us. Just that little bit of time, like the tire that got traction. And we're not alone. As we all do that, whole families could be transformed. Communities, nations, the whole world. This is how it happens. Not trying to move everything all at once. Not seeing the great problems that are beyond us, but just starting from inside. Seeing where those changes can be. That is taking this great talent that all of us have and opening us up to an array of blessings that we don't even know that we can have, receive, and give to others yet. It's making the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, real to us day by day. Taking that special extra time, thinking now about how this year will be different than the past. Are those first steps in taking this talent, full possession of it, and handing it back to the Master, so that when He comes to us anew, either this year, at the end of our lives, or at the culmination of all times, we can show what we have produced with what He has already handed on to us. And hear that blessed phrase that we all long to hear: well done, good and faithful servant. I am indeed of God, the Father of the Lord, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our Savior is crucified and conscious of God. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will not end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen.
Grateful for the gifts that we have been given, we ask for the help we need to serve God faithfully as we offer Him these prayers.
For church leaders, may God look graciously upon them as they faithfully steward the riches He's entrusted to them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the world, may the Lord guide us with wisdom in our role as stewards of the resources of this earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who experience the pain of separation and divorce, may the love of God sustain them through every trial. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this faith community, may the Holy Spirit grant us courage and strength as we live our call to discipleship. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Those who have died, may the Lord's mercy grant them eternal rest. And for Brenda LaSalle, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of all good gifts, we know that you are with us as we answer your call to act boldly in your service. Hear the prayers we then offer to you today. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all the Holy Church.
Grant, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer in the sight of your majesty may obtain for us the grace of being devoted to you, and gain us the prize of everlasting happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, we give lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Holy Spirit, you gathered them yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity may the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit, by to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you and with joy we proclaim.
Amen.
Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit. You give life to all things and make them whole, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he sent the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for men for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy
peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to our apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant you peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever."
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We have partaken of the gifts of the sacred mystery, humbly imploring, Lord, that what your Son commanded us to do in memory of him may bring us growth and charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before the final lesson, two things to point out in our bulletin. There's two inserts this week. One is a financial report. It's a little late getting to you, but I very much appreciate the efforts of our finance council to put all that information together. And just as a note, as your pastor too, I get to see things as they come in, and your care for the church is so evident. In fact, there's quite a few of you who can't be here with concerns of the virus and being out in public, but are so generous in making sure our church is taken care of. So anybody looking at me through the camera today, thank you. We miss you. We look forward to seeing you again. And it's just surprising, in a way, edifying. There are some people I have not yet met, but yet have reached out by letter and keeping us in mind. So we thank you for that. The second insert, something happy as well, is the Christmas cookies information. About that, we have them. I made my way through a bag and a half, so I'm pretty sure they taste good. So a lot of quality assurance this year. But they are the sugar cookies as being here traditionally. So thank you for the people who put in their time and efforts and donations and everything to make that happen. So there's information about how to pre-order and the days that you'll be able to pick them up. And finally, before the general blessing, I want to ask our Lord to bless any of our veterans that are here and those who cannot be with us today. Heavenly Father, through your Son's priestly right hand, extend your blessing upon all veterans gathered here today. We ask that you bless them in abundance with the spiritual graces that acknowledge their sacrifice for their grateful nation. May their needs be met everywhere. May they be kept safe in this world and guided with good conduct safely to the next, where you live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And thank you on behalf of our whole parish for all those who are veterans, for their service, and in all those promised prayers for their continued protection. God bless you for all that. Thank you.
Michael,
we are ready. Defend us now.